Story. Tilting at windmills. On Monday night, monsters crawled out from the closet and under my bed. They had no eyeballs, only empty sockets of pitch-black darkness. Their teeth glistened from the moonlight streaming through my bedroom windows. I shrunk back under the covers, hoping that the nightmare would go away. But the monsters, they were too real. They breathed down my nightgown. They reminded me of my older brother who would always tease me by throwing food down my shirt. They crawled into my blankets, their voices shrieking in delight. They tore at the wall until I was no longer in my bed or in my room or even on the surface of the planet. I was in the monster's domain as I scratched and I punched to no avail. They were strong, like the slaps of mother when I didn't get good grades. I cowered in the corner, backing away, no longer trying to fight a battle already lost. 5 of the dozen monsters surrounded me. Then, they swallowed me whole. On Tuesday night, bats and snakes flew in the window. Why the window was open in the first place was a mystery to me. The bats flew in at all directions. They bit me everywhere. From head to toe, they nicked my forearms, pinching my neck. The snakes were no better. Though they could not fly, they used all their strength in gnawing my heels till they bled. The ground stunk of my own blood and the venom from the creature's teeth. I was sure the blood would have reached my parents' room by now. I was sure they would come and shoo away the bats like parents were supposed to do. I was sure the snakes would go away if I only told myself, this isn't real. But I couldn't. It was so real. Too real. Once again, I was surrounded by horrible creatures. And suddenly, they pushed me out the window. The last thing I saw were the bats and snakes taking over the beautiful bedroom I once called mine. On Wednesday night, the grass on the lawn grew rapidly. Like extending knives, the grass blades reached taller than the houses in a blink of an eye. They wrapped around my ankles, making red markings around my foot like the scars from Father's daily whipping. They pulled me down underneath the ground. Below the roots of trees and below the rocks and sand, it kept pulling me down. Miraculously, I could breathe even with the little oxygen I had. But I wish I wasn't breathing. I wish I was dead. I guess that was what the grass wanted to do to me, to make me want to die. There was no end to the dropping. I screamed, like I did when bullies placed a dozen centipedes in my gym locker. I could not go up. I could not escape the torture. Is this real? Is this real life? Or am I fighting imaginary battles? On Thursday night, the weather was horrible. I did not even have the comforts of my own home. The skies shook with thunder and there was lightning everywhere. I could not tell myself everything was fake or that everything was just in my mind. It was simply all too real. I could taste the rain on my lips and my clothes stuck to my freezing body as the rain pounded down. I thought I might have gotten hypothermia. The coldness reminded me of the times my parents locked me in our garage for a week straight, for no apparent reason. Suddenly, I got struck by lightning, over and over and over again. The electricity surged through me, though I never did die. But the pain. The pain made it even worse. It was worse than the pain I received when my older sister broke my arm because I touched her purse, even worse than the pain from being rejected by every single teacher at my school. The pain made me want to crawl in a hole, fall asleep and never wake again. On Friday night, I was at school. I thought that maybe tonight the pain would be over. A young girl like me should not have to bear all of this, real or imaginary. But I was wrong. When I entered the classroom, my classmates all turned to look at me. Their gazes were so strong, so full of hatred and so darn real. They pierced through me like lasers. I could not tell myself it was all in my mind. Because this was far too real. Annie, Beth, Roslyn, Jefferson. I knew these people. Annie, who ripped my homework to shreds every time I met her eyes. Roslyn, who told every single one of my old friends that I did drugs, making them turn on me. And Jefferson, the one person I thought actually loved me for who I was. Jefferson then came up to me, his warm brown eyes replaced with glowing red ones, and sliced a knife through my abdomen. On Saturday night, I was prepared. I was prepared for the battles. My mind was steady. My heart was strong. My knees didn't wobble and my jaw was clenched in concentration. Tonight, I would win the battle. But nothing could have prepared me for the horror. My mother, my father. They came up to me and hugged me. Whispering, caressing my cheek and lifting my thin body into their arms. But I could not hear their words, I could not feel their warmth. I could not speak and tell them I love them even though they hurt me in every way possible. I could not even return their kisses. The next few moments were the best in my life. They were so lovely, so beautiful. There was no slapping, no punches from drunk parents. No hurtful words from those you loved most. It was so idealistic. I should have known from the start that it was all in the plan. It was part of the horror. But I had been so absorbed in those moments that I never had before. I wanted to treasure every second of it with no other thoughts. And then, it all disappeared. With one last hug, one last kiss, mother and father set me back to the cold sidewalk. They turned their heels and walked down the alley. Suddenly, everyone, everything I knew, joined mother and father on their walk. Everyone, even the bullies from school and my evil siblings, walked away from me. They walked away and away. They never looked back. I was alone. No harming classmates. No ruthless parents. No one but my own mind. I wish they were here. But I was the only one checked in this asylum. I was in a maze in a mansion and I was playing hide and seek with reality. I could not find reality and reality could not find me. It was so close to me, a blink of an eye away. Yes, I was in my asylum, and I could not check out. I was stuck in this mansion. So lonely. So desperate. And I realize then that bleeding, painful tortures to my body are nothing. A bullet through the brain. A blade through the heart. They are merely dewdrops to thunderstorms. No. The worst torture was being alone. Living in a silent world, closed off from everyone else. It was not a monster I could fight nor a battle I could win. Being alone meant there was no one for help, no one to die for. No one to live for and no one to love. Tilting at windmills meant walking alone through an empty field for eternity where a battle had been fought. And a battle had been lost. Story.